Welcome back, Troglodytes, to your daily dose of guitar information, the Trogly's Guitar Show. I was hunting reverb tonight, and I came across a very peculiar-looking Les Paul. It's advertised as a 2007 Les Paul Standard in an ebony finish with its original hard shell case. The price doesn't seem so bad. The shipping cost, a tad high, but livable. Let's take a look at this thing. Oh! I love it. It looks so doofy, but yeah, this is going to be a super versatile instrument. Okay, so in case you didn't see it, somebody has swapped out our neck pickup with this very strange one that has three pole pieces up here, and then it has three pole pieces down here. Normally, a humbucker pickup has them all in a row like this, but oh wait! No, we're sharing this guitar not because of the weird neck pickup, but somebody added a middle single coil to a Les Paul. Now you might say that is absolutely crazy, why would anybody ever do this? But believe it or not, there actually is a factory stock model from Gibson that looked like this back in the early 90s. Basically, the Gibson M3 series was moved onto a Les Paul Classic like this, and there was also a Studio Light version available with the same electronics. Needless to say, these things don't show up very often, and let's be honest, most people that want a Les Paul, they don't want this, but it's kind of cool in a quirky sense if you're looking for something different. Currently, I do not see any for sale on Reverb, but sometimes you'll find them. But this person just built their own M3, but with a traditional Les Paul layout, so you've got a toggle switch on the upper horn, and you've got the four control knobs on the front. But let's see, have they changed anything else out? It looks like they've taken the pickguard off, but left the screws in, so that gives it a certain vibe. I think it would actually look okay with a pickguard, but they would probably have to do a little bit of additional routing to it. And it appears that they've actually went as far as putting black hardware on this. Kind of a black chrome, I guess you could say. Not just straight up black, if we can believe the photos. The headstock, they left it alone. They didn't convert it to like some strange 7-string or something. But that neck pickup just gives it the vibe of somebody like tilting their head and going, huh? But the golden bell knobs work really well with the lightly aged plastics and the cream binding. And I like the way that the middle pickup kind of plays stealth with that black finish. This actually looks halfway decent. And it appears to be in good shape. So despite the modification, this thing has not seen tons and tons and tons of play wear. Original case is always a nice plus. The 2000s TKL cases are actually very nice. So let's read the description here. So apparently that middle pickup is a Lindy Fralin Blues Special. Looks like something like this directly from their website. It's worth about $100. And you can read all about the technical specifications here. But I'm curious about this neck pickup here. What's that? A Lindy Fralin P92. So is this actually a humbucker-sized P90? Kind of, I guess. It says it's a full-sized humbucker with unique looks, but advertised as a more articulate P90 with no hum. Okay. Looks like something this would actually cost, $160. That's a pretty expensive pickup. And apparently they've got it wired up so that middle position can be activated with a push-pull pot. So that means if you had this in the bridge position, you could pull that up to also bring the middle pickup in. So you're using that push-pull pot to kind of get the in-betweens. I guess you could go as far as like putting a 5-way type toggle switch on here. But that's kind of unique because then the middle position, instead of being the middle pickup, will be your traditional Les Paul middle pickup sound, and then you can bring that middle pickup in if you want it. So it'll be a super versatile instrument, that's for sure. And apparently for some reason they deactivated these controls, so it's just master volume, master tone. I guess they probably had to do that because it'd be very confusing of how to control that middle pickup otherwise. So I wonder if that was just a limitation on their knowledge or a limitation on what they had available to their disposal without, you know, crazily modifying the guitar. I mean, it was pretty crazy to add a middle pickup to it to begin with, but they didn't want to modify it any further. But with this one being 8 pounds, 7 ounces, this has definitely been chambered. But at $1,799, that's going to be a lot cheaper than an original M3 Classic. So, I mean, if you're looking for something a little bit different, you could definitely make a deal with this shop for that, because it's really not priced that aggressively. In fact, I would say a deal and or a steal would be about $1,400 to $1,500. So good luck on that if you wish to purchase it. Let's see, what else can we find tonight? We've got a solid 2007 Les Paul Studio here. Ah yes, the beautiful Arctic White finish. The best thing about these guys is they still retain the ebony fretboards, even past the golden age of studios in the early 90s when they had the ebony boards. any studio with an ebony fretboard that's been a little bit worn in, they really do hit just as hard as a standard or a custom, in my opinion. These were sleepers for so many models, and people never fully appreciated them. Because there's a lot of guys, they'll get the studio, they'll listen to my advice, they'll pick one of these things up, something with the ebony fretboard, and then they'll end up trading it away to get the standard or the custom or something higher end. But then they learn to regret it, and now these things are just going up so far in value. I would never suggest buying a brand new Les Paul studio. And I like new guitars now. Some of them are a fantastic value and you should buy them. But if you're buying a studio, just find yourself a 90s era studio or even a mid 2000s with the ebony fretboards. Those are my favorite. There's nothing wrong with the rosewood fretboard versions. It's just the ebony feels so great, especially without the binding on these. And the white looks fantastic. So you might, you know, stick your nose up at a $1,300 studio, but a brand new studio today is, I believe, $1,499. This thing's actually pretty clean. I definitely see it selling in that $1,100 to $1,300 range. Let's see here. Yeah, that was listed 3 hours ago, so if you're interested in this, I would get your offer in as soon as possible. I feel Reverb really needs to update their price guide because some of these estimates are way off. Finding a studio for $600 to $750 anymore, they're gonna have headstock repairs. You used to be able to buy them all the time, you know, $600, $800, but now it's like, you know, the low 1000s anymore. And you see, I'm not alone in this raving review of the white versions. Even this guy's saying, get the white one with the ebony fretboard or bust. But hey, what is going on here? A Gibson Invader in a walnut finish? Man, that looks so much like a DePaul from far away. Apparently it's mint condition. I have a hard time trusting things like that, because like true mint condition Invader, despite being an undesirable model for most people and collectors, a pure mint condition one or like a custom colored finish, that is going to have an appeal to somebody who likes to collect the oddballs. I gotta say, yeah, this thing so far is looking very clean. Ooh, even has a Gen 3 chainsaw case. I don't think it counts as mint condition if it's got that. But it's got a little bit of wear. I don't know if this is just me, but if you're describing something as mint in the title, the very first thing in your description shouldn't say nearly mint condition. Just pick one. I mean, I know you're advertising it as excellent, but I guess that's just to get you to click on it. Let's see what else has been listed today. Ooh, prehistoric 57 reissue. You don't see these things too often. So technically, prehistoric means anything built before the historic custom shop opened in late 1993 for a custom shop reissue style guitar. Now, in my opinion, I don't really count the 90s models as much as prehistorics, but by definition, they do fit in there. But the super desirable prehistorics in my eyes are the early 80s ones. So this one's got a little bit of a finish irregularity here. That looks like maybe splines to me that somebody put in the back of the headstock. So this has definitely had some sort of a repair and it appears to be in good condition otherwise, except for, oh, I wonder if that has to do something with the break and the repair, or did it really just wear like that? That seems a little bit unnatural, but it depends on the player's style, I guess. But it kind of gives it some character depending on how you feel on stuff. So how much is he asking for this guitar? Okay, $3,000. I'm not much of a buyer for repaired guitars, but that looks like an okay repair. Maybe it could have had a better touch-up job, but that's something you can always do later on. Looks like some people have had success anywhere between $3,000 to $4,000 on originals. This is kind of an outlier. Maybe it was in 100% perfect condition. And then these other ones, the market's changed so much over the years. It's also possible that this was just a regular 1992 Les Paul custom that somebody sold. That this was just a regular like 1992 Les Paul custom. That's why it's good to use this as what it's intended, a price guide, not a 100% price set in stone type thing. Okay, troglodytes, thank you for tuning in today. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe, and we will catch you tomorrow on the next episode. Take care.